just discovered in the pulpit that my comrade must do some really heavy-duty study. Young's analytical concordance to the Bible, the interlinear Bible in Hebrew, Greek, and English. The truth of the matter is, it's to prop your papers up a little higher so you can see them, but nonetheless, what's impressive? Oh, this is not working. Yeah, is that picking me up? Okay. But I will turn, Jordan, I will turn on the lapel mic and that will make sure that it gets me all the way. Jesus' genealogy in the book of Matthew includes five women of, well, suspect reputation. One pretends to be a prostitute in order to snare her father-in-law to have him perform a duty to her called levirate marriage. One actually is a prostitute. One commits adultery and benefits from her husband's murder. And one is a hated foreigner, prohibited from taking part in Israel's worship. And of course, there's Mary, an unwed pregnant teenager. This sets the frame of our story from Luke. Ruth is remembered because she is the great-granddaughter of Israel's great king, David. And ultimately, as Matthew shows us, the ancestor of even Jesus Christ himself. That genealogy is not all that pure like the Israelites would have liked it for it to have been. God has worked through some very strange people and some very disreputable women. And yet, God's purpose has won out. Our story takes place in a town we know very well, Bethlehem. It's situated in what is called today the West Bank. It's part of the Palestinian Authority. And it lies across the Jordan River from a country that we know today as Jordan, but in that time, nearly 3,000 years ago, was known as Moab. Now, Naomi was a woman married to a man named Elimelech. And they had two sons. I'm not going to bore you with their names. They're not worth remembering. You'll find out why soon. They had a famine in Bethlehem. They were always on the edge of just barely having enough to eat. And now they didn't have enough to eat. And so Elimelech decided that he and Naomi and their sons should go from the plateau where Bethlehem was, down the banks into the valley of the Jordan River, up the banks of the east side, across pasture land that wasn't any good for growing crops, but was great for sheep and goats, around the Dead Sea, finally into the fertile areas of Moab. And there, for 10 years, they lived. Well, at least some of them lived for 10 years. They had a good experience there. There was plenty of food. Elimelech was able to find work. Both of their sons got married to Moabite women. Now, by the way, the Moabites were the ones who were prohibited from becoming part of Israel's worship, because the Moabites and the Israelites were at war with one another and one or the other of them, when they won, would place the other one under tribute. Isn't it interesting how history repeats itself over and over? Israel and Jordan have been at war. And even now, the peace between them is tentative. Nothing is new, as the preacher says in Ecclesiastes. But anyway, while they are there, Elimelech dies, and both of the sons die, leaving Naomi a widow with two widowed daughters in law. Now, just as in so many parts of the world, and especially the Middle East today, a woman without a son or a husband was indeed a woman without. The only social security system there was that she had a husband or a son to take care of her. Naomi, Ruth, and Oprah are destitute. The story writer says that the Lord sent food back to Bethlehem, and Naomi heard about that. And so she decides she's going to go back home, where at least she is known, and perhaps she might be able to find a living somehow. And so she tells her daughters-in-law, you know, stay in Moab. Don't come with me. There's nothing here with me for you. Even if I should happen to come up with children of my own, you would be so old by the time they were old enough to marry you that it wouldn't be any good. Oprah decided that she would go back indeed and find perhaps a husband among her own people. But Ruth was a different story. Ruth decreed that she would remain with Naomi. You know the world. Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates me from you. That's a passage that used to be read fairly regularly in wedding services. I finally just dropped it from my wedding services because so many couples ask that it be removed. They really didn't want to make that kind of commitment to one another. That's a comment on divorce and everything else. So Naomi and Ruth make that long walking journey back across the fields, the pastures, the valley, to the plains of Bethlehem. And they're received with great joy. The women welcome Naomi. They ignore Ruth, by the way, who, after all, is a Moabite, a former, a queen, somebody who doesn't belong there. Naomi, you can sense her feelings when she says to the women who greet them, "Don't call me Naomi, call me Mara." That is, don't call me pleasant, call me bitterness. Because the Lord Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full. Well, not really, did she? She went away from a famine, but she still remembers it that way. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. The Lord has afflicted me. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me. Now, could there be a bigger statement of depression, of anxiety, of anger than that? No, it is one really ticked off, depressed lady. She doesn't even acknowledge that Ruth acknowledged Ruth. So, there was a social security system available to Ruth and Naomi. And when the spring, because that's when their harvest season is, when there was the barley and the wheat harvest, those who were destitute, especially widows, could follow after the people who were harvesting the grain from the field. And in fact, the Bible makes it very specific that those who were doing the harvesting were not to clean the field absolutely, but were literally supposed to leave some of the grain there in the vine in the field in order that the widow, the poor, the orphan, those who were without support otherwise could come along and glean it. That is, pick it up for themselves. And so Naomi, who is herself, an old lady, about 40 probably, but the life expectancy then was 40. So she really was, at that time, old. She's not able to go out and do that work, but Ruth is young. She's someplace in her 20s, perhaps. She would have been married originally as a teenager, middle teenager. She goes out into the field. Naomi sends her to a particular one because she says, there's a kinsman here of ours named Boaz. Go to his field. Boaz sees Ruth gleaning in the field, and he recognizes her evidently as a foreigner, but he had heard about her. And he says to her, what are you doing here? And she tells him. And he says, very well, you have been faithful to Naomi, and that is good. And he instructs his workers two things. One, they're to leave a little bit more so that Ruth can pick it up. Two, they're not to bother her. Sexual harassment was just as real then as it is now. And so she does this, and Boaz gives her all kinds of extra grain to take back to Naomi. It's a wonderful experience. Naomi finally figures out that, we need to have what they call a kinsman redeemer. That is, a man who is a close relative who will, in fact, take them under his wing, his protection, and provide for them. So, Naomi hatches this wonderful plan. Ruth is to get all dressed up and the best clothes she possibly can have, get all cleaned up, take a good bath, anoint herself with some nice perfume, and late at night, she's to go to what was called the threshing floor. Now, in an ancient village like that, there were two primary places of communal meeting. One was the wine press, and the other was the threshing floor. Now, the threshing floor was where the workers, when they were threshing, and you know what threshing is, was simply when the wind was right, because the threshing floor was always up kind of high. When the wind was right, they threw everything up into the air. The grain, which was heavier, would fall to the ground, and the chaff, the stems and all of that, would blow away. And they would pick it up and bring it together. So, at night, the men didn't go back home. They just plunked down exhausted on the threshing floor and went to sleep. Boaz was among them. And Naomi said to Ruth, go in the middle of the night after Boaz has had a good meal and a little bit to drink, and he's feeling very comfortable. And go there and lift up his cloak, uncover his feet, and lie down beside him. Now the scene, and I won't bore you with the euphemisms and details of that in that scene and in those words, but you can figure them out for yourself. The scene is sexually charged, to say the least. You've seen the picture on the front of the bulletin, and you will notice that the scenes in it, which are from the 13th century, show you in the lower left corner Ruth sneaking under the cloak of Boaz. They're wonderful. They're wonderful. In the old days, people weren't able to read, so this is how they learned their stories. One of the pictures that I almost had them use it's about from about the same time, or maybe a century or so later, and it shows Boaz looking down at Ruth, and he has the most unbelievable expression of consternation and confusion on his face. The artist has captured that moment when Boaz says, "Who are you?" And Ruth tells him. Now, the biblical storyteller is not interested in this being a steamy romance novel, nor is he a Hollywood producer. So, it's just left at that. Boaz blesses Ruth when she tells him who she is, because he knows her to be a faithful person to Naomi. And Ruth says, "Will you take me under your wing? Will you place your cloak over me?" Now, she was cold, so why wouldn't she ask for that? That isn't what's going on. Oh, no, not by a long shot. What's going on is that when a man in that time was going to marry a woman, he took his cloak and put it over her. Ruth is proposing marriage to Boaz. She's pretty bold, even more bold than Naomi. Boaz says, "Yes, but there is another man who is a closer kin to you." Like all good storytellers, there has to be something that diverts the plot. And he goes to this and he says, "There's somebody else." And there's some legality work. It all of it comes about that closer kinsman doesn't want anything to do with Ruth or with the property that comes with her. And so the final scene of the story is very simple. That Ruth and Boaz, who is probably a little older than she, some of the artists, some of the rabbis wanted to make him really older than she. The only problem is, of course, is that he couldn't have been a whole lot older than she because they have a kid. And that's the point of the story. And at the end of the story, those same women who greeted Naomi at the beginning and she complained about being bitter, those same women come and say to Naomi, "Praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer. May he become famous throughout Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you and who is better to you than seven sons, has given him birth." Now, at the beginning of that passage, you thought they were talking about Boaz. But no, in the end, they're talking about this child, Boaz. story is a wonderful story. It's only 85 verses. It's shorter, but it's barely half the length of Psalm 119. But it's a story of fidelity. Someone has commented that the family and the church are both places where we have opportunity to live with people we did not choose. Our fidelity to those who are stuck with us can be a reflection of the fidelity of a God who is stuck with us all. God is at work in surprising and unexpected ways. God often works, the story tells us, through the most unlikely of people, outsiders, strangers, the outcast, the alien. And in all of this, it's united by one characteristic that's mentioned three times in the book of Ruth. You heard Conrad talk about it a few Sundays ago. Chesed. You're going to be very Hebrew about it. It's got a cuss at the beginning of it. Chesed. It's an ugly word with a beautiful meaning. Loving kindness, loyalty, and chesed is said of Ruth, and of Naomi, and of Boaz. They act in the same way that God acts. And it is to that that we are called. It is to that action of loving kindness and care and fidelity and loyalty to one another, to God, and to the stranger that we are called. It finds its greatest meaning, of course, in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who took that Old Testament law that excluded outsiders and made it to include Ruth is a point along that journey to Jesus Christ. And for that, we give thanks to God. Let us join together as we sing hymn 507, A Mighty